abundant life and life in the world. In what very well may be the oldest book of the Bible, that is the book of Job. And Job, it seems to me, addresses very much. Job addresses that issue. So Job says, man that is born for us a few days is full of trouble. Man that is born for us a few days and full of trouble. Now, there are two kinds of two phrases there that are important. The latter, I think, gives us the most trouble. The first phrase that we clearly is important is man's a few days. We understand that, but I think most of us are okay with that. Because, you know, longevity, especially in the United States, is continuing to get longer and longer. We all know a lot of people who live into their 80s. We have some folks in our church in their 90s. Last year, we had a lady who turned 100 years old in our church. And I think most of us feel like, look, if I can make it into my 80s, I'm good with that. Now, here's the phrase that gets to the difficulty, and that is, that he says, man that in a few days will also be full of trouble. He doesn't say, look, there's a possibility, just an off chance, that you might have a little bit of trouble, or it's possible that you might have some difficult days. He doesn't say any of that. He says, man that is born of only a few days and full of trouble. Well, that's just the opposite of what we want. We don't want trouble in our lives. We want surgeries that are pain-free. We want desserts that are calorie-free. We want vacations that are stress-free. We want traffic that flows smoothly. We want arteries that never will clog. We want sleep that is not interrupted. But that's not how our world is. And just open your Bible and just see what the Bible says about that. And so in your Bible, you will read from the very beginning the suffering of Abel in Genesis and the suffering of faith in the book of Revelation. And in between in your Bible, what you will find are fiery furnaces and lions' dens and prisms and storms and disease and death. From the morning newspaper to the nightly news, and we will see all of them. When you open your Bible, it's interesting that we'd like the Bible to read kind of like a fairy tale. We'd like to read our Bible, and yes, there may be a big bad wolf, and there may be some evil villains along the way, and maybe some poison apples that we have to navigate, but when all is said and done, everybody lives happily ever after. But you and I both know that's not the real world. And we know, when you pick up your Bible station or you watch the news, what we read about every single day are the after effects of living in the fallen world. And so there are long nights in a hospital with statues to the cemetery, and their parents are buried their children, and children are buried their parents, and their jobs that are lost, tears shed, addictions endured, their marriages broken, friendships that are ruined, and sometimes congregations that are divided. Now, maybe you're listening to all that and saying, well, you know what, Dad, that may be some people, that's not me. Well, God bless you for that. I mean, if you've lived a Teflon-coated life where nothing bad ever sticks to you, God bless you for that. Thank God for that. But I will tell you that most of us have lived a much different life than that. We've lived a much more challenging life, a much more difficult life, a much more real life. Man that is born of woman a few days and full of trouble. Not very long ago in Triple Terrace, where I had preached now for a quarter of a century, I taught some lessons out of the little book of Habakkuk. Now, that's not usually where people go for sermon material, but it's a wonderful book. In the book of Habakkuk, you have an ancient world, but you have a man who is asking modern questions. And so a prophet looks at his world, and he asks the questions in our world. And so when you read the book of Habakkuk, he asks it like this. He says, God, are you listening at all? He said, how long, O Lord, shall I cry? Will you not hear? Have you ever done that, ladies and gentlemen? Have you ever prayed to God, and it just seems like that in the middle of your pain, you're not hearing anything back from God at all? And this is exactly what Habakkuk says. Jeremiah said that. Jeremiah chapter 3 said, God, I pray to you, but you put a covering over the heavens so that you will not hear. So if you ever cried out to God in the midst of your pain, and heard nothing in return but the silence of heaven, and he said, does God care? He said, I even cry out to you, but there is violence, and yet you will not stay. So says God, do you care? Habakkuk says, look, God, I'm living in the middle of evil and injustice and suffering, and seemingly you're not doing anything about that. And so he says, God, do you see what's going on? I know you see what's going on. Do you care? You tell us you care. Well, why aren't you doing something about all of that? And thirdly, Habakkuk asks, God, are you good? Why do you show me iniquity? Why do you cause me to see trouble? What a most difficult questions in all the Bible to navigate is, if God is such a good God, then why offer this world such an evil place? How can a good God tolerate a bad world? And Habakkuk asks that. He says, God is good. And then Habakkuk will say, where's the power? Where's the power? Plundering, violence are before me. There is strife, and temptations arise. And so he's saying, God, why don't you do something about that? Are you going to protect your people who are suffering in the middle of all this strife and destruction and violence? And then finally, it leads to a question that is asked in the New Testament at the end of the Bible, Revelation chapter 6. God, can I trust you? And so the saints on the altar, the book of Revelation, who have suffered much, the reason that they are under the altar, if they have been sacrificed on the altar, these saints cry out, and they say with a loud voice, how long, O Lord, holy and true, that you can judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth. And so, those are ancient questions, but really they're our questions. I mean, if you've lived long enough, if you have enough mileage on the odometer of your life, I will guarantee you at some point in time, you've asked one or more of those questions. Those are real and valid. And so often is the case with Paul becomes our role model. You know, Paul once said, be followers of me, even as I also am of Jesus Christ. That's a good thing for us to do, to look at him, particularly when we think about the storms of life. Because I guarantee you, whatever you've endured, whatever I've endured in life, it pales in comparison to that great apostle. I mean, you're a good Bible student, so you know this, don't you? He was beaten and stoned. He was chased and imprisoned. His apostleship was questioned. His preaching was criticized. He was abandoned by his friends. He was discouraged to the point of despair. He was depressed and set beyond measure. And yet, in spite of all of that, he never quit. In fact, Paul would say, when we are cursed, we bless. When we are persecuted, we endure. When we are slandered, we answer kindly. In Romans 8, he said, I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that should be revealed in us. But the sufferings of this present time for Paul were formidable. So the Corinthians, he would chronicle all of those things that he endured, and the list is long and impressive and daunting, and the lesser man surely would have given up. We mentioned Job a moment ago. What did Job's wife tell him to do? Curse God and die. But not Paul. That thought never entered his mind. Paul realized that a Christian has tools available to them that others do not. I want you to think about that with me. Paul realized that a Christian has tools available that others don't. Now, don't misunderstand me this morning. I want you to listen carefully, please. We're not talking here about just the problem of positive thinking. I don't think the Apostle Paul would have signed on to Joel Osteen's mantra about you're living your best life now. I mean, if this is our best life in this world, then, as Paul would say, we have all been the most to be pitied. And it's not cliche. You never read about Paul saying, look, when life means you're living, you need to make some living. You just don't hear Paul say that. You never hear Paul say, God never closes the door without opening a window. I don't even know what that means. But you just don't hear Paul citing those kinds of cliches. Think about those kind of cliches that we say sometimes to try to mitigate the pain that others go through. I think you can mistake like that. Well, tell that. Tell that to the wife whose husband is dead. Tell that to the parent whose daughter is addicted to drugs. Tell that to the middle-aged man who has just lost a job after 20 years of work. Tell that to the mom and dad whose son has announced that he is gay. Tell that to the kids who have to make a decision for their parents about assisted living or nursing home care. Tell that to the man who goes to the doctor and always expecting that he gets some antibiotics and before long he is scheduled for chemotherapy. Tell that to the Christian who's part of the congregation and his daughter. Discouraging if there really are no prospects for the people. But Paul is saying it's deeper. If you have your Bible this morning, I want to read a little bit in 2 Corinthians 4. 2 Corinthians 4, if you have a Bible, the verses will not be on the screen. So let's just read them together as the text this morning. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And we'll spend the rest of our time in this period right here, this little section of 2 Corinthians. So let's read it together first. 2 Corinthians 4. Let's begin at verse number 7. This is what he says. 2 Corinthians 4:7. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, at the excellence of the power, maybe of God, not of us. We are hard pressed on every side, and yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Though always we carry about in our body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. Verse 16. Therefore, we do not do so. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, because we do not look at things that are seen, but at things that are not seen. Things that are seen are temporary, things that are not seen, they are eternal. So let's stop right there. Here's what I want us to do in the minutes that we have left in this section. I want us just to look at that section of Paul's writing and ask, how do you survive and how do you thrive in the storms of life? Because this was a man who knew all about that. So how do we survive and thrive in the storms of life? Let me give you a few notes on that screen. Let me give you two or three things quickly. For one, well, first of all, says his heart was founded on the rock. Not a rock, but his heart was founded on the rock. And so here's what he said in verse 7. We have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. When he writes in Ephesians, in Ephesians 1, he said, look, I want you to pray that God will use the same power that he used to raise Jesus Christ from the dead, that he will bring that to bear in your life as he answers your prayer. Paul believed that everything centered, the center and circumference of everything from him was God the Father and the Son of Jesus Christ being involved in his life. Colossians 1:27, Paul would say, look, Christ is in you, and he is the hope of glory. And the point of that is that when we're dealing with something that is bad, we want somebody with us that we believe can make a difference, don't we? When things are bad, we want somebody with us that we believe can make a difference for good. When I was preparing this lesson last year, I read a story about a family mom and dad that took their little boy into bed for the night, and a story kid. The boy woke up, and he's doing a thunder, he was under his feet, standing a lightning in the shadows of the tree outside his window were going. He got scared, he started to cry. And so he couldn't. And of course, his mom, not dad, but mom got into go in and check on him. Mom goes in and checks on him, she gets him all calmed down, and tucks him all back in bed. And she says, well, I'm going to go back to my room. He said, well, can't you stay? And she said, no, come on, I've got to go back. And I'm going to go back with your daddy. Of course, he said, big sister. Well, most men are when you think about it. But you know, the point of that is, that little boy wanted somebody with him that could make a difference. And we all do, ladies and gentlemen. We all want somebody. And Paul says, well, that somebody is God. We've got to remember that and embrace that. His heart was founded upon a rock. Remember what Joseph said to his brothers? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about as it is this day to save many people alive. You know what the key to Joseph's life was with that? There's a statement in Genesis 39:2 that says, the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man. The unbroken theme of the life of Joseph was that over and over the text says, the Lord was with him. I will tell you that the great men and women of God, that's what mattered to them. That was the sentiment of his promise, by the way, when he said, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? Well, he contemplated some of the options. He said, you know, I could go into the heavens, I could go to the grave, I could get the morning sun to the east and the setting sun to the west, but he said, even there, your right hand will guide me. And that's the point of that, that God is with us. It was the sentiment of Moses contemplating leading the people of God. And he thought about everything he was going to need for that. Supplies, managers, and equipment. But most of all, he said, good, look up. If your presence does not go up with us, then don't bring us up from here. In other words, look, if you're not going to go with us and be with us, then just please let us stay. Because the presence of God was critical to him. Now think about David again. David ended up in Egypt in his own making. He was in his own captivity by his own bad actions. And yet, when he thinks about that, and he prays about that, he doesn't pray and say, God, I know what I've done, but please don't take my crown from me. Please don't take my kingdom from me. Please don't take my people away from me. What David said was, do not cast away me away from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Those are good things to pray. We ought to pray that. God, I need your presence, the presence of your Holy Spirit. That was the summit of Paul. God said, look, I would never leave you, nor will I forsake you. And Paul believed that, made all the difference to the world. So his heart was founded on the rock, which means would be naturally, secondly, death. That secondly, his death was from heaven. That would just mean logical, wouldn't it? If his heart was founded on the rock is God and Christ and the Holy Spirit, then that would mean that he believed that his death was from heaven. Now, here's how Paul said that. He said, we believe, and therefore we speak, knowing that he who raised up the Lord Jesus Christ will also raise us up with Jesus and present us with you. And so again, Paul says, look, I'm praying that the power that God used to raise Jesus from the dead, that will be used for us as well. So much of that, ladies and gentlemen, is Paul's work that our hope for the future is based on God's promise for today. In fact, when the psalmist wrote his most famous song in the Hebrew hymn book, what did he say? He said, I will fear no evil because you are what? With me. Because you are with me. Somebody as well said that God never promised the absence of pain. He promises the presence of the shepherd. That's what David said in the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. I will not be found wanting for anything. Think about the way God spoke about that. God said, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you through the rivers, and they will not overflow. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burnt, nor shall the flames scorch you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior, and that amazing promise. I think there are two things in those verses that we probably don't like very much. One is the path. Did you notice that? Look at the words that are still there. He said, you guys pass through the waters, and through the river, and through the fire. Well, we'd rather not do that. We would rather that God pick us up and put us on the other side. But in other words, God is saying, but there's some things you just have to go through. There's some things that on earth you just have to experience and go through it. And I think the other thing we don't like in that verse very much is the pace. When you walk through the fire, well, who wants to walk through fire? We don't walk through fire, we run through fire. We want to zip, fly. We want to get through that as quick as we can. But God is saying, look, there's some things that you've got to go through, and sometimes the only way you get through is if you walk. What does it mean to walk? Well, it means to proceed one step at a time. That's what walking is. It's moving one foot in front of another. And God says, look, when you walk through the river, the flood, and the fire, I'll be with you. It may not always seem like that. It may not seem like that sometimes. But you're fine. To a backup or a joke. But God does not promise that I will be with you. I think, ladies and gentlemen, sometimes we read that and we wonder, is that really true? Is that just Bible talk? I mean, is that just talk that we talk about on Sunday and what preachers say or read Bible classes, or does it really ever work like that in real life? We know the Apostle Paul is reading about it. He thought that it did. Look at what he said. He said, therefore, having obtained help from God, to this day I stand witnessing this call and ready in Acts 26. But I want you to notice what he said, the reason I'm able to do that is, I've obtained help from God. And I look at this passage. I said it before. He writes in Timothy and said, my first offense, no one stood with me. All forsook me. But the Lord stood with me, and the Lord strengthened me, so that the message might be preached only through me. I want you to think about that. The Lord stood with me and the Lord strengthened me. Let me ask you this one. How did God do that for Paul? I don't know. He doesn't say. Paul just says in both of those passages, the one thing that I know is that the Lord was with me and the Lord stood with me and the Lord strengthened me. How did God do that? I don't know. He doesn't say that. He just says that God did that. There was one occasion when Paul was talking and he said, we were as low as I was, as low as I've ever been in my life. And he said, God comforted me by the coming of Titus. Maybe that's one of the many ways that God does it. It's by bringing people into our lives who help us, encourage us, and make us better, because they were here not long ago at Temple Chairs. That's when Vicki and I were. Vicki, my wife, Vicki and I were in a home of some things that happened. And there were two other families there. And so there were angels sitting around the dining table. And we're talking and laughing, and two of the couples are not there very often, even in other parts of the country. And I listened to everybody talk, and I just kind of stepped back a little bit, and I looked at these other three families. And I thought, you know what? These three families, that there is nothing that if I were to call them day or night, there is nothing that I could ask them of what they would try to do. How encouraging is that? To know if you've got that kind of friendship and relationship of people that God has brought into your life. That's one of the reasons why God gave us a church family. We're not just church members like you, we're church family. We're brothers and sisters in the family of God. We have a common father. We serve an elder brother, but we are brothers and sisters. I think one of the ways that God strengthens us and stands with us is by giving us family just like that. No wonder the Bible says he will never leave us or forsake us. And he may not always explain exactly how he's with us or what the exact ways are, but that's the promise of God, that he will not leave us or forsake us. And then his life was enhanced by the experience. And that's interesting. I want you to look at this passage with me again. Let's read this together. This is verses 15 through 17 that we read a moment ago. All things before your sake, that grace, having spread through the many, may cause thanksgiving to abound in the glory of God. And therefore we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. Our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. And so Paul says, look, my life, whatever I'm going through, he said, my perspective is that this in some way is of benefit and value. There are two sides here of this that I think are important. Number one, his life was a benefit to others. But don't miss that, ladies and gentlemen. His life was a benefit to others. Look at verse 15 with me again if you have your Bible open. All things are for your sakes, that grace, having spread to the many, may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God. And so he says, look, I'm willing to go through this if it helps you. Look at this. God who comforts us in all of our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves have been comforted by God. Do you see a theme in that verse? I mean, you would have to work to miss that, wouldn't you? Where Paul is saying, look, I've gone through some terrible things. I've suffered some horrid things. And yet he said, God comforted me so that I might be able to comfort others with the same comfort which God showed me. Old gospel preachers used to say that God pours into us so that we can pour out into the life of others. And I think that is right. And so whatever it is that you've gone through in life, whatever it is, whatever particular challenge it is that you have overcome, do you realize, ladies and gentlemen, what a tremendous resource you are? How encouraging you can be to other people. How you can reach out to others that are living here who are dealing with the same challenge and the same struggle. And you can talk to them about that. What are the things in the resource that is? And so on the one hand, his life was a benefit to us. On the other hand, he said, this has given me the perspective to my life. And so in verse 17, look at what he says. Our life affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. What an amazing perspective that is. Here's a man who says, I was shipwrecked, I spent a night and a day in the deep, I was beaten with rods. He goes through all of this. He said, I know I was hungry and thirsty. And he says, you know what? All of that is just my life affliction. When you compare it to eternity, it sounds very much like 2 Corinthians 12, when he had prayed about his thorn in the flesh. And he said, Jesus answered and said, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. And Paul then says, therefore, most gladly I will boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. When I am weak, then I am strong. What an amazing perspective that is. You know what that's saying, ladies and gentlemen? It's saying that at some point in time, we've got to decide if we really believe what we say. This world is not by hope, just passing away. Whether those really represent the sin of our Father, whether they were just the words that we said this morning. My dad and my mother both passed away. They were living in California when my dad was diagnosed the first time with cancer. Ultimately, he was cured. But he had a very difficult time with his cancer. He had really lived his very difficult time with multiple rounds of chemotherapy. It was really struggling. And I was preaching with Houston, Texas at that time. My office one day, I got a call that there was a nurse on the floor in the hospital where he was. He said, Mr. Truex, I'm calling you. He said, I really think that if you want to see your dad again, you probably should come right now. And so I called Vicki and I said, I've got to go here for you. I called and I could get a flight. So she promised to close the office when I was in California. Now, please start in California. I've got there waiting for you. And then I went up to the hospital. Here's my dad. He's deep in his sleep. And so I just spent my life there all night. And didn't know what the morning was like. But the morning, when he woke up, as oftentimes happens, he was much better. He was just much better. And so when he wakes up, he looks over and he sees me and he says, what are you doing here? And I said, well, dad, honestly, I got to tell you, the nurses called me yesterday and said that they were afraid you would not live with the doctor. They told me that you would need to go home. And here's what he said. He said, oh, son. He said, I always look for you, but I'm done. He said, it's for that day that I'll live my whole life. And I thought that's that perspective. My life is fiction. Which is best place to otherwise, is working far more to do than it is for you when you're poor. But you know what, ladies and gentlemen, about all of that was lost for us. Because everything that he has said, all of that was undefeated. His future was in his hands. There's a statement here before we stop this morning in this session. I want you to look at this statement. It says, therefore we do not lose heart. Even though the outward man is perishable, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. Now, Paul uses in this passage a literary device that he uses often in his writing called bookending. That is, he will start a section with a phrase and he will end the section with the same phrase. And so in verse 1 of 2 Corinthians 4, therefore, since we receive this ministry, since we receive mercy, we do not lose heart. And that's the way he ends this section in verse 16. We do not lose heart. We do not lose heart. Now, it's interesting that he says in verse 15, even though our outward man is perishing. You ever thought about that? Our outward man is perishing. We don't think a lot about that. We don't even think about the fact that others can see that our outward man is perishing because we don't notice it. We look at ourselves every day in the mirror, so we really don't notice it. You know what the great news is? Others will be kind enough to point that out to them. Isn't that sweet, folks? Isn't that wonderful? I attended Florida College, which is a little school in the community where I lived. And we had, a couple of years ago, we had our 40th class reunion. We started high school that year. But a few years before that, we had had our 25th class reunion. When we had our 25th class reunion, there's a classmate of mine, a lady who goes to church with us at Temple Terrace. She and I, we headed up to the reunion. And we were having a luncheon at a restaurant there at Temple Terrace. And so we were having our group in the front of the restaurant. and the 20th class reunion was in the back. And so, Shannon, this lady and I, we're standing in the front, and we're greeting all of our classmates for the 25th reunion when they came in. And so we're greeting all of them. But then, this couple came in for their 20th reunion, and I know both of them, and they were going to the back. And they were walking past us, and this is the absolute truth. The husband, they got 3 or 4 steps beyond us and thought we couldn't hear, and then because we're old. And the husband said to the wife, he said, "Can you believe we're going to look like that in over 5 years? Unbelievable." So, the outward man is perishing. I get it. I understand. I understand. Wow. At my 40th class reunion, I was on Monday night after the lecture, I was looking for my reunion group. And I went to a place, and I went there, and so I went to another place. And there was somebody coming out, and I said, "Hey, I'm looking for the class to study." He said, "Oh, it's right there. That's it." He said, I said, "Great. I said, that's my class." And he looked up and said, "Really? What did you teach?" Isn't that something? It's unbelievable. Unbelievable. The outward man is perishing. And yet, look at what Paul says. We don't lose heart. We don't lose heart because that's going to happen. It just naturally happens to everybody. But that's not what matters. We don't lose heart. We have a phrase in America, that his heart's not in it. We know what that means, don't we? If your heart's not in your work, your day's going to be long, your mind is going to wander, your boss is probably going to feel it because you're probably not doing your best. If your heart's not in your marriage, you may share a house, maybe a closet, but you're probably not going to share much more than that. If your heart's not in worship, then you don't just finish it. You'll watch the clock and you'll be miserable. You'll really do everything but worship. And if your heart's not into serving God, as Paul talks about here, if your heart's not into serving God, you might get minimal effort. You may try for a while, but eventually the world's going to win. But it doesn't have to because look at this. We can be renewed. We can be renewed day by day. Fresh, thriving, joyful, Christ-like. The difference is Jesus. There's no cliche that says pain is inevitable, misery is optional. And I'm going to tell you, there's no passage that says that. For Paul says, "Look, we struggle. We are struggling. But it's that we've chosen. We've chosen not to be visible. We can, there's so much in this world that we can't control. But we can't control how we respond. What did Paul say in Romans 12? He said, don't conform to the world, but what? Be transformed. And how do you do that? By the renewal of your mind, so that you can prove what is a good and perfect and acceptable way." Well, my plane landed on that Saturday after being hired at Prince of the Morning. I had some interesting travel days, kind of like yesterday. I've had a lot of interesting experiences flying. I've had flights delayed, and I've had flights that have been canceled. I've been rerouted in different cities because of bad weather. Sometimes, like yesterday, where we had some mechanical difficulties that messed up the schedule. I've had bags that have been damaged and bags that have been lost. I had bags that left the plane they were on so much that when I got home, they just had to stay for a while. But you know what, ladies and gentlemen? Once I was home, none of that really matters. So I think that's what Paul's saying. So you could be explaining. You know, oftentimes, life doesn't turn out the way we plan it. We can get on all of those things and we can use them to be visible to all of us. We can be renewed day by day by the choices we make and the devotion we offer. Because one day we call it what it calls them. Our citizenship is recovered from what's wicked earlier way to sin. He's been the Lord of Jesus Christ. And so if at this morning there is some obligation that you are a government of public order, I invite you to have time to see Christ. And I come home to him. That hope of heaven is truly yours. That this invitation is for you. Let's take it.